chapter. John chapter 17. Verses 20 through 23. John chapter 17, verses 20 through 23. And you shall find these words. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. Verse 22, I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Pray with me, if you will. Gracious God, we come to say thank you for this opportunity to deliver and to hear your word. We confess that we need to hear a word from you. A word that will change our lives for the rest of our lives. We need to hear a word that will change our direction, that will change our attitude, that will change our outlook, that will change our perspective, that will cause the sun to shine in the dark areas in our lives. We need to hear a word from you. So speak, Lord. And as you speak, we who have ears, help us to hear what the Spirit has to say to the church. We praise you and we thank you for your word. And we thank you for what we shall hear on today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For the time that is ours to share, I would like to attempt to preach from the subject of God's desire for unity in the body.
All right.
God's desire for unity in the body. Well, ever since January of this year, we have been looking specifically at the prayers of Jesus. And we have been looking at specific prayers ever since the beginning of this year. And we wanted to get an understanding of what happens when Jesus prays. And so today we find ourselves for the second time in the Gospel of John, the 17th chapter. The last time that we looked at this particular text, we were in the second section of this chapter, which went from verses 6 to verses 19, where Jesus was praying for his disciples. But now as we continue to look at this text, we find ourselves in the third section of this text, which begins at verse number 20, where Jesus is in essence praying for all believers. Well, there was a gap between the last time that we looked at this chapter and this time, because I wanted to focus on this whole idea of seeing the glory of God. I wanted us to understand last time we looked at John the 11th chapter, where Jesus says that the death of Lazarus, we would see the glory of the Lord. And so now we find ourselves looking at this 17th chapter, and it's important that we went back to chapter number 11, because we're going to see again this whole idea of the glory of the Lord. Well, in this third section of John's Gospel, the 17th chapter, we now see Jesus beginning or continuing his prayer. You remember the last time that I talked to you from this chapter, I said that there is a distinct difference to me between Matthew chapter 6 and John chapter 17. We were taught growing up that Matthew chapter 6 was the Lord's Prayer. And you've heard me say over and over and over and over again that I don't believe that Matthew chapter 6 is the Lord's Prayer. I believe that that is a model for prayer that the Lord gave. In Luke chapter 11, when the disciples asked Jesus to teach them how to pray, he gave that to them as a model for prayer. But in John chapter 17, we actually see the Lord's Prayer. And so Jesus in this chapter, part number one, he was praying for himself. Part number two, he was praying for his disciples. And now in part number three, he is praying for the future believers. But it is interesting in this prayer that was in three parts, and in itself, even in the third part, there are many different parts to his prayer for all believers. I submit to us today that it is the Lord's desire that there be unity amongst the believers. And so as he was praying, he said to his Father that I am not praying only for myself. I'm not praying only for my disciples or my homeboys, but then I am now praying for all of those who will later come to believe because of the message that the disciples would later go out and to deliver. You see, church, when we look at this whole idea of unity, there is a spiritual principle that is at play. Because unity in and of itself, just because we say that we are together, doesn't mean that we are together. Can I get a witness, somebody? Just because we use the word united, just because we use the word unified, does not necessarily mean that we are together. But there is a spiritual principle that is at work, which we can extract from this text. Number one, you see, in order for unity to be present within the body of Christ, we must be together in our purpose and in our mission. Can I say that again? We must be together in our purpose and our mission. And so as we begin to look at this text, his prayer was that all of the believers, those present and those who are to come, may be one. Well, the first is that how do we define what one is? One is, as Jesus says, as you, as I and the Father are one. Now that kind of leads us into a greater theological debate of this debate of what is the Trinity or how God expresses himself. And so somebody says, well, our church believes in the Trinity. Does that mean that we believe in three different gods? No. We believe that there is one God that expresses God's self in three different persons or three different ways. God the Father, who is over us and is the Creator. God the Son, or God the Redeemer, is the more appropriate way, is the God who is with us, who came onto the earth and walked with us, just as Elder Solomon, we are walking with each other in ministry. Jesus came on earth and walked amongst the disciples. He walked amongst the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He walked amongst the people, and then he redeemed them from the curse of sin and brought them back into relationship with the Father. And then there is the third person, which is the Holy Spirit, which
that Christ left for us when he went back to the Father, and the Holy Spirit is our teacher, is our comforter. Somebody might say, well, what is the Holy Spirit? Some people say that we have this subconscious. And you know how it is. It used to be on TV, there was the good angel and the bad angel. And so really what the Holy Spirit does, the Holy Spirit is the part of God that lives on the inside of us. And as the Holy Spirit is on the inside of us, then it is the Holy Spirit that reminds us of what the Lord did when he was on earth. It's the Holy Spirit that reminds us of what we should do and what we shouldn't do. And if we get off a track, then it's the Holy Spirit that is on the inside of us that convicts us and says, you know what? You got to go back and do something over again. The Holy Spirit is the part of God on the inside that says, you know what? Maybe you shouldn't do that. It's the Holy Spirit on the inside of us that says, hold up. Wait a minute. Think about this before you do this. And so what Jesus says is that in this text, the Holy Spirit had not yet been revealed. So he says that just as you and I are one, make them one. So somebody says, well, we have one God who expresses God's self in three different persons, but yet they are one. And that is the model for unity that Jesus desires for all of his disciples. That we are one. One in our purpose and one in our mission. But you see, church, that is how it's so easy for us to be distracted from our common purpose and our common mission, because even in the body of Christ, there is so much to divide us. There's so much that comes to distract us, even as we are attempting to do the work and the will of God. And so Jesus says, my prayer for all of my believers, those that are present and those that are future or to come, is that they might be one, and one in their purpose, one in their mission. But this is the part that really intrigues me about unity within the body of Christ, is that we have ultimately one common purpose. We ultimately have one common mission. But the ways that we carry out that purpose are so diverse that I might be able to reach one group, but then Elder Solomon might be able to reach another group. The thing that I like about God is that in the pulpit, I might be able to reach somebody. But then outside of the pulpit, Mother Gilchrist, you might be able to reach somebody. But guess what? If I can't do it and Mother Gilchrist is able to do it, that doesn't mean that I'm no less of who I am. But one of the tricks of the enemy is to come in and to divide us. And to say, well, I got my agenda, and you got your agenda, and that one got their agenda. But one thing I like about it is that whenever we are on the same page in the Holy Spirit, our purpose is Christ and him crucified. Our mission is to go out into all the world and baptizing them and teaching them and converting them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But you might do it one way. You might do it another way. You might have one assignment. And another one might have another assignment. But just because you are affected at your assignment doesn't take away from another person's assignment. Because at the end of the day, whether your mission is to reach the women, or whether your mission is to reach the youth, or whether your mission is to reach the men, at the end of the day, Jesus said, what? If I be lifted up from the earth, then I will do what? Draw what? But you see, that's how the enemy comes in and tears up the body of Christ. Because the enemy wants to come in and make us believe that we are each other's enemies. That we are against each other. Oh, no, 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 no. Just as
once we are together in purpose and in mission, what unity also says is that because I am together on purpose and in my mission, then there is a fruit, there is a byproduct, there is some evidence that I am together with my sister and my brother, and that evidence is called love. Let the church say love. Because Jesus said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, your love for one another. And I wonder if there's anybody here who knows about love. Because love doesn't mean that you always agree on everything. But love is saying that even though you are different than I am, that I look past. And that's why the enemy comes in and tears up the body of Christ, because what we look at, we want to make each other the enemy by pointing out the differences and the faults and the flaws of each other, instead of saying, you know what, whenever I see the Jesus in you, you might not dot all your I's, you might not cross all your T's, but I can see the Jesus in you. Meets the Jesus in you.
That's it, Pastor.
It's so easy. I believe that it was the old James. I think it was the old James. I'm correct if I'm wrong. That said, people all over the world, join hands and get on the love train. The love train. Well, in essence, that's what Jesus is saying. Is that when my believers are together on one accord, that the connector between each cart in the train is called love. Love is what keeps the train together. And although each cart or each train or each cart in the train has its own little different purpose, but it is love that pins each of the carts together. And then when they are together, then they can make forward motion.
Jesus.
So our knowledge of our purpose and our mission, then it is evidenced by love. And with love, that is only when we can make forward motion. You see, church, Christianity is not a stagnant movement. But it is a movement which moves and progresses forward. The thing that causes Christianity to be such a powerful, movement is that it is not relegated or discriminatory based on a person's race, a person's gender, a person's social creed, but what it says is whosoever will. Remember John 3:16, Jesus said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have an everlasting life. Just as look around, look to your left, look to your right, look behind you, look in front of you, look up, look back. Everybody that you see is one of the potential whosoever wills. When you leave this place, go out and look at all the people who are on the street corner. Those are potential whosoever wills. And what the Lord says is, once the body of Christ within the church comes together on one accord, then we can make forward movement and to let all of those persons who were told they were nobody, to let all of those persons who were told that they were outcasts, to let all of those persons who were told that they made mistakes, to let them know that they are a whosoever will. And to make that thing personal that says, you know what, you might be a whosoever will, but guess what, I was a whosoever will at one point too. so Christianity is a forward movement. It is a movement that requires forward motion, and that motion can only take place when we are connected by love. And then, as we are moving forward, then we can bring our message. Somebody says, well, what is the message? I like what Jesus says as he continues the prayer, because he says, I have given them your glory that you have given unto me, that they may be one as we are one. You see, that term glory is very important. Remember, I told you a couple of weeks ago what that word glory was, because the glory is the manifestation of God. Or somebody said, well, manifestation, that's a big word. What does manifestation mean? What manifestation means is I can see it. Something was promised, and now I see it. And so what manifestation is in this context, Jesus revealed to his disciples and to the world everything that he was. He revealed the fact that he was a miracle worker. He revealed the fact that he was able to turn water into wine. He revealed the fact that he was able to open blinded eyes. And he gave all of these signs. He revealed the fact that he was the resurrection and the life. Each one of these signs that Jesus gave was revealing the glory of God. And whenever we have a full concept as to who the Lord is in our lives, then we can say as Paul, I am persuaded.
Yes,
that I am persuaded that neither death, a life or death, or any other thing will be able to separate me from the love of Christ. Why? Because I tried him. And I knew him. I didn't have to ask anybody. But I tried him for myself. I know who he is. Because I tried him in the midst of my sickness. I know who he is. Because I tried him when I was in trouble. I know who he is. Because I tried him when I didn't have a cent in my pocket. Oh, when you know him for yourself. Then what it says is, I link up my testimony to your testimony. And that's what the Bible says. And they were overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And so as I link myself up to you, because I know who God is, and you know who God is, and whenever we are in agreement on who God is and what God can do, not what we read in a book, but what we know for ourselves, then that binds us together, and that makes us an undestroyable force. Oh, and that's what the Lord wants. And so the time has this. He desires for us to be an unbeatable force. And oh, what would happen in the body of Christ, not just within Antioch, but what would happen if the body of Christ would really come together on one accord, not based on what my denomination is. Because at the end of the day, I can care less if you are a Baptist, if you are a Pentecostal, if you are a Holiness, if we can all come together and say every knee must bow. And every tongue must confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. So what it says is that there is a love chain. And so the principles of unity is that we are together in purpose and in our mission. Then when we are together on purpose and mission, then love must be the underpinning that connects each cart in the train. And then we are able to make forward action. And then, get this, then we must be fruitful. Let the church say, we must be fruitful. We must be fruitful. How would you feel which you began to plant a seed. And that seed, let's say it was a watermelon seed. And you cultivated that watermelon plant and you saw it grow and you made sure that all the weeds were picked out and you did everything that you were supposed to do to make sure that at the end of the day that this watermelon plant would produce watermelons. But then when harvest time came, instead of watermelons, you just had a nice, pretty plant. But can I be honest with some of us? Because the thing that Jesus has with us is just like he had with the fig tree. Was that you look nice and pretty. We look nice and pretty. We know how to put on our collars. We know how to put on our Stacy Adams. And I got mine on too. We know how to put on our robes. And we know how to look the part. But then at the end of the day, when it comes time for our production, we are not productive because we are not bearing fruit. So unity says, not only are we together, but together are we producing fruit.
Yes, sir.
All right. And so, that's what Jesus is saying. Is that we must be together,
yes, sir,
in purpose and in mission. We must have love connecting us. Love is what helps us to move forward. And then as we move forward, then we are able to produce fruit. But then there is something else that the Lord wants us to know. Because what he says in the second part of the prayer is that, Father, I want those who have given me to me, I want them to see my glory. I can't get past this whole idea of seeing the glory of the Lord and the glory of the Lord being revealed. A lot of people look at the miracles of Christ and say that those miracles are relegated to the biblical narrative. But some people say, well, those miracles, they might have happened back then, but they're not happening right now. But the devil is a liar. Because somebody might say, well, Pastor Messi, when was the last time you seen blinded eyes being opened? But can I offer you another question? When was the last time you saw a person make a decision to make a change in their life? You bet the church said that's a miracle. When was the last time that you saw somebody say, I've got to change what I'm doing? Bet the church said, that's a miracle. When was the last time you saw somebody say, well, you know what? What can and what must I do to be saved? Let the church say,
that's a miracle.
When was the last time the doctor gave up on somebody and said that there was nothing else that could be done? But some way, somehow, when the face of God turned to God in prayer, then God turned the situation around supernaturally. Let the church say, that's a miracle. But lean over to your neighbor and say, neighbor, if none of that stuff works for you, but then just look at me. Because when you look at me, you are looking at a miracle. You don't have to look it up in a book, but just look at me. Because you're looking at a miracle. The very fact that I am alive, the very fact that I'm looking at you, and you're looking at me. God's plan for the church, which is unity, is nothing more than God saying that there's something that I need the whole world to see. But the only way that they can see it is that they see it through my believers. What Jesus is saying is, in and of myself, I've done all that I can do. But what I've done is I've given my 11 disciples the tools that they need to go and carry this work forward. Then those 11 disciples went and ministered to others. And those began to minister to others. And those began to minister to others so that we can see the glory of the Lord. Oh, yeah. Well, somebody might say, well, Pastor Messick, why do we need to see the glory of the Lord? Because when we look at the world that we live in, there are a whole lot of people. I'm not talking about anybody in the world. I can just talk about myself for a little while. Anybody like that? Because there are a lot of people who are struggling in the world, and what the Lord wants us to see is He wants us to see His glory. And part of God's glory is knowing that with God we can have favor. Because I define as the tangible evidence that a person has the approval of the Lord. You see, in 2 Chronicles 16 and 9, it says that the eyes of the Lord run to and forward throughout the whole world to show Himself strong and mighty. And church, I'm so glad on today, that's all that Jesus is praying for. He's praying for unity within the body of Christ. For He says in His word, He says, righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you. And they that know you have sent me. And the other thing He's saying is that there are many people in the world that don't know who God is. And they don't know what God will do. But if they begin to look at us and see the way that we walk, if they begin to look at us and see the way that we talk, if they begin to look at us and see that when life's strong storms come upon our lives, we don't give in and we don't give up. When they begin to look at us and they see that we don't respond the way that everybody else responds, what will happen is they will begin to look at us and they will say something is different about you. They will begin to look at me praise for unity in the body. Today as we rise to our feet, should there be one? With the personal God. If there's one here today, if you need to make a decision for Christ, we invite you to come. And if there's anyone here today that does not have a church that you call home, and you desire to unite or reunite with this Antioch Female Baptist Church, we invite you to come. Whosoever will, let them come.